Well, tell us an interesting fact about yourself.
Interesting. I don't think a lot of people would know that I did have a really bad injury where I was told I'd never play again. That's quite interesting, but I was on a ward after playing a game for Brentford at Bradford away. I was on a ward in Yorkshire, and I don't live far from it now actually, because you know where my family ended up settling. And I went up for a ball and a lad decided to head me head, and had a double depressed fracture of the skull. Just me and two other very nasty for them, because them two folk died. And I came through. I think the doctor always said because I was a real fit sort of footballer, it helped. I had a bleed on the brain, all that, but told I'd never play again, but I had to. It was me, you know, it's what I love doing. It was my livelihood as well. And back training within a month, back playing within 3 months. The team had done well without us, but David Webb put us back in the team. We beat Cambridge 5-2, I made 4 goals, headed 1 ball and had a headache for a week. So that's quite interesting stroke, uninteresting, but it actually happened, and it was a weird time for me and my family, but we came through it, definitely.
What's your best Gazza story?
Best? I've got some funny ones. I mean, the one that people don't believe is that he used to enjoy, I don't know why, but he used to enjoy going in the big tumble dryers. Tried to get me in once, and I fought about 4 or 5 apprentices off. You couldn't do that now. Obviously, you'd get probably in trouble, but obviously, we got up to daft things when we're apprentices. But Gazza actually enjoyed getting locked in, as long as you didn't, it wasn't put on hot and it was on cool. And actually, it prepared him well, because one day he had a bit of a thing with Billy Whitehurst, was a real hard man, real tough guy. And Gazza had been cheeky to him. Billy chased him into this back room, and the kit man went in to help Gazza because he thought Billy was going to fill him in, and Brian Clark, and Billy couldn't find him, and Brian was like stumped. And anyway, Brian went back in about 2 or 3 minutes later, and Billy had give up looking for him because he'd been cheeky. And Brian opened the tumble dryer, and a hand came out from all these clothes. And he said, "Thank God you came down and had to kill us." So that's typical sort of what he would do. But I mean, you couldn't, with Paul, you couldn't, Gazza, you just could not rest. I mean, you'd be sat here now and I'd stand up in my toilet. Somehow he'd been hiding underneath your table, and your shoelaces would be tied together. Every time you went to the canteen with his apprentices and you went like that, he somehow got in before everybody else and loosened the salt and pepper cellars, and you ruined your food. And he just was constant, non-stop fun and craziness.
Your friendship with Lee Clark, obviously you worked with him here at Killie. Like, how far back do you guys go, and like how good family?
Well, Lee was an apprentice in Newcastle, a schoolboy in Newcastle when I was playing. So you know, and obviously Lee got in the team early. I got in the team at 17/18 in Newcastle. Lee got in, you know, 16, sort of that age. But I played against Lee, funny enough, when he was 7-year-old and I was like an 11-year-old at school level. And then you could see then he was going to be a good player, but you know, he's playing up against like lads 4 or 5 years older. But we'll go back a long way, Lee, and he's, you know, he did a fine job here, as you all know. And probably 40 odd years I've known him, so yeah.
You and the manager got to know each other at Norwich, is that right?
Yeah, obviously knew Tommy from my time at Newcastle, although I did move on quite quickly. And but then we got back together at Norwich. Tom came in as a goalkeeping coach under Glenn Roder. I was first team coach. We had a fabulous first season there. We were 6-7 points adrift at the bottom. Got at one point within 3-4 points of getting in the playoffs, but then fell away a bit at the end. But then that was the first time I worked with Tom. Got on great. We've kept in touch ever since. And both been on my different sort of pathways, as you do. And finally had the chance to get together again.
How do you spend your time away from football? How do you relax away from the game?
I have to keep fit because it's just the way I think I am. I've been built that way. I enjoy trying to get out. I love getting out with my hybrid, my bike. Very mountainous where I've been living in West Yorkshire. Lots of hills. The Tour de France went through there, through air back. So it's. But I brought my bike up recently. I'm going to get on it. I'm going to try and get up the coast a bit and enjoy the West Coast here. It's beautiful. Try and high the odd in. That's Newcastle. Throw the odd hill in as well. So, but yeah, and a game of golf, which, you know, is pretty much land of golf here, isn't it? So if I get the odd day where I can go, I'll go.
Was the first thing you want to do when all this COVID restrictions and things have passed?
I want to cuddle my mum, without a doubt. She's 84. She's on her own a bit, you know, because nobody can get to see her, but my sister, my brother, all of them, I think everybody just wants to have a good family get together, have a few beers together, have a few laughs. I think that's what it's all about, isn't it, now?
Absolutely. If you could live anywhere in the world, where would you choose?
Oh, anywhere in the world. There's a place we've been a few times for our holders called Anna Maria Island and down in Florida. It's absolutely amazing. We've been there 4 times in the last sort of 15, 20 years. Probably be there. It's as good as anything. My son loves his fishing. You can kayak, you can bike, you can have a beer on the beach, you can fish. So it's perfect. So yeah, probably be there.
If you could only eat one meal for the rest of your life, which one would you choose?
Oh, that's a tricky one. I'm going to be boring here and say something like mince and dumplings. I like the old traditional meals, me. Or fish and chips. I love fish and chips if it's really good. Yeah, probably fish and chips I'll go for.
Hero, footballer otherwise?
Johan Cruyff. Loved him as a player. Watched him play. Even his coaching was pretty amazing. But just grew up watching him. Loved how he moved, just so elegant, majestic, could beat people. Love players who can take players on, because, you know, they create overloads for you, give you opportunities. But he was just brilliant. I loved him in particular, and Maradona. But obviously, when you realise, you know, Maradona was a little bit more crazy, I think Cruyff would have been my hero, without a doubt.
What's your go-to karaoke song?
Your song. All day, Elton John. I'm sung that a few times for the lads on trips and that, and when I was a player, and obviously initiations when you go to new clubs, you've got to sing a song. That would be my go-to song, definitely. But we can't do that at the moment because of COVID, because the spray, so we're not allowed yet.